a new band of rebels arose who were determined to carry the fight to Jerusalem.
The Sicarii.
To the Sicarii, anyone who wasn't fighting the Romans was a collaborator and worthy of death.
Many were slain every day, and the fear men were in was worse than the calamity itself.
Right now, we stop here. We're saying all people. let me read down. Verse 8, the Lord God has gathered the outcast of Israel, saying, yet will I... The Lord God has gathered the outcast of Israel, saying, yet will I gather others to him besides those that are gathered to him. So he's talking about the outcast of Israel. The outcast of the people that they God will let. That's what he's talking about.
Shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years.
Right, and they shall afflict them 400 years. Now, going back all the way before the Exodus happened, all right, the Israelites, the 12 patriarchs, were put in the land of Egypt, okay, and they were a stranger in that land because nobody knew who they were. You know what I'm saying? They became afflicted for 400 plus years.
It says verse 14. It says, and also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance.
Right, they shall come out with great substance. You know what I'm saying? They did take a lot of substance from Egypt, like gold, silver, you know what I'm saying, copper, whatever they wanted. You know what I'm saying? He came in the image of his father. He came in the likeness of the Lord's doctrine.
Like, because until Jesus came, they were servants of his father. But he said, I'm not.
Well, yeah,
the servant does not know what the master.
Yeah, I know. I'll get to that point. I'm trying to get to the point of the covenant. You know what I'm saying? The covenant was established with him. You read that in Genesis, right? Now this is the New Testament. This is during Paul's ministry to the ancient life. This is Romans chapter 9, verse 2. That verse 3, for I could wish that myself were accursed with Christ, for my brethren, my kindred, according to the flesh. Or verse 4, who are Israelites, the ones pertaining to the adoption, the glory in the covenant, and the giving of the law, and the service of the God, the promise of the covenant.
Obedience, they
don't really, really see the picture.
You don't understand that.
captivities and scattered around the whole world. That's the city, the Israelites.
Yeah, just like your forefathers was conquered by the conquistadors, you know what I'm saying? They were flipping, they were putting an arm on it. This is Psalms 148, 147 and 19. He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel.
He shows his word to Jacob. We know Jacob is the father of the 12 tribes.
He showeth his word unto Jacob.
God shows his word to Jacob. You know Jacob, that's right.
And his statutes and his judgments unto Israel.
That's him saying Jacob again unto Israel. He shows his word to Jacob. He shows his statutes and his judgments to Israel. To this one nation of people, right?
Verse 20, he hath not dealt so with any nation.
He hath not dealt so with any nation. So the statutes and the judgments, his laws, that he showed to Jacob and Israel, he said, I haven't done that with any other nation. I haven't dealt with any other nation the way that I'm dealing with this nation. It don't matter what our feelings are. This is what God is saying. All right, go ahead.
So with any nation that, I mean, that he hath not dealt so with any nation, and that's for his judgments, they have not known them.
That's for his judgments, they have not known them. See, the Bible has judgments written for every single nation. Just like our judgments were written, and we came to be on those boats right there, that was a judgment that was written. What was the source that was going to happen? That we broke the laws and the commandments. These other nations, their judgment hasn't happened to them yet. So that's for God's judgments, they don't know them yet. You know what I'm saying? So we know we got judged. We know that's why we don't have our last day. That's why we're in a whole other country that really isn't ours underneath the nation of people. These other nations haven't had that happen to them yet. You know what I'm saying? But it's getting ready to. So it doesn't matter what we think. Every nation has a judgment that's written out to happen to them. People try to save whoever they want, but whatever God says is going to happen to them, that's what's going to happen. There's no getting out of it. And you look at those boats right there. All those people on those boats, I'm pretty sure you can find one person on that boat who was a good guy. You know what I'm saying? You believe in God, try to keep the commandments, but guess what? There was a judgment that was going to happen to the whole entire nation if we broke the laws and commandments. So what happened? The whole nation came. You know what I'm saying? No getting out of it. You know what I'm saying? No matter how you feel, the heart might be like, okay, well, you know, Jesus loves everybody, he's 99. That's not how it works. It's all about what the Lord is saying. You know what I'm saying? It's a call game, man.
Christianity
there's not one religion, or there's not one holiday.
I consider myself not a Christian, but
someone that believes
that, that's when I first became was a Christian.
Right.
But through that, I consider myself a Nazarene.
A Christian, the word Christian was a derogatory term that they used to put on the disciples and say, oh, look, them guys are a bunch of Christians, you know what I'm saying? They're following Christ. That's all the word was. The Israelites, the ones that follow Christ, they're the real Christians. Christianity is the religion that's full of shit, you know what I'm saying?
Right, you know what I'm saying? That,
well, only through faith can we have a relationship with God, because in the Old Testament we were not revealed, God didn't, you know what I'm saying? So only through faith can we have a relationship.
I'm not disagreeing with you, you know what I'm saying? You know, but we show our works by keeping the law. Let me go ahead and get
it says Christians are disciples.
Yeah, the Christians, the prophets. Christians
were
disciples.
So even in the Old Testament, the prophets were actually the ones that they were speaking to the Holy Spirit.
Let me get this in James. Verse 1. And after these things, I saw four angels standing on four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor the sea, nor any tree.
You know, and I saw another angel ascending
from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of God in their forehead.
These are the servants of God.
The servants, right?
Right. This is, he's going to seal disciples. The servants of God in their forehead, right? Now let's see who the servants of God is. These are the only people who are going to get the seal of the living God in their forehead, according to the Bible, not according to how you feel. Okay. All right?
But it says when Moses was gone for 40 days and 40 nights.
Let's stop going to jump
those
around.
Who worship,
no, let's not jump
idols.
Around. Let's deal with the 144,000 first, and then let's talk about Moses, all right?
Verse 4. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000.
Right? That's what we're talking about. Go ahead.
Yeah.
All the tribes of the children of Israel.
All the tribes of the children of Israel are the only ones who are going to get the seal of the living God on their forehead.
Right.
Thus saith the scriptures. Not what I'm saying as a man, it comes from my own heart. This is what God said. That's it.
Only through adoption.
That's See, you're ahead of stuff. We just read what the Bible said. It didn't say how many to adoption. It didn't say all that. It said 144,000.
Oh, yeah, no, yeah, just going back from what we read in Romans.
What we read
in Romans 9 chapter, the Israelites were the only ones that pertained to the adoption. All right? That's what we read.
But everything, even in, it says in Hebrews, everything is through faith.
No.
You keep saying faith. You keep going back to that. We didn't say nothing.
Because,
I mean,
you haven't seen God, right?
No, I haven't.
So you have to believe through what you haven't seen.
Right. So that's why we keep the law. To prove that we do believe in when we do have faith. That's why we try to keep the law. We're not disputing the faith thing. I don't know why you keep going back to faith. We are together with faith. But just because people have faith, that does not mean that salvation is open to the whole entire world, every nation of people. That's not how that works. How do you know that? That's not how it works.
I mean, like in Ephesians 1:4, it says, Jesus, before the foundation of the earth, he chose his disciples.
Right. Yeah.
So those that were of disobedience and did not follow the law, given the law, it says to follow the law is to become cursed.
Here's the thing about that law. The ones that are disobedience is the ones breaking the laws and commandments. The ones that can only break the laws and the commandments like you read are the Israelites. They're the only ones that can retain any kind of judgment from the Lord for breaking these laws.
So even Jesus, he was of the immaculate creation.
No, he wasn't.
So he wasn't even of the line. I mean, he was from Judah and Levi. But he was, technically, he was not.
Technically, what? Joseph and Mary had sex. It was a sexual act that happened. God didn't have an angel fly down to Mary with sperm in his hand and put the sperm in her stomach. Man. Jesus' mom and dad laid down and had sex with each other, and that's how he was born. That's why the Bible tells you he was going to come from the seed of King David. Jesus told you out of his own mouth, I am the root and the offspring of David. You know what I'm saying? To be somebody's offspring.
But it said, like, some people believe that Mary and Jesus are the twin souls of each other.
Let me show this to you in the law. Right? Let's go back to the law. We're going to go right back to the law.
If you're under the law, then you're not under faith.
The law is how you show that you have faith. That's why it says, show me your faith without thy works, I'll show you my faith by my works. Tell me this. So when you said, I'll show you my faith by my works, what works do you do to show that you have faith?
By me having faith right now and speaking to you is my works.
But what does the Bible say?
My faith.
What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say your works have to be to show your faith? You show your faith by keeping the Lord's commandments. When the Lord tells you to do something, you do it. It's just like when God told Abraham.
But the Lord's going to tell me something different than God's going to tell you.
He's not telling you nothing different. It's right here in the Bible. It's right here in the Bible. It's commandments in the Bible.
That's our words, though, right?
Okay, the Bible says thou shalt not. The Bible says thou shalt not murder, right?
Like when you.
Does the Bible say that?
Yeah.
Okay, so it told you the same thing that it told me. How is the Bible telling you something different than
it's
telling me?
But in my heart, if I have hatred in my heart and I'm like, you know what I'm saying, like I say I want to kill that person right there, that's murder right there.
Yeah.
Okay, that's cool, but that's in the scriptures though, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's the same thing. We're seeing the same thing. The works is when the Lord say do something according to the Bible, you do it. Just like when Abraham, remember he told Abraham, you remember when he told Abraham to go kill his son? To go stab Isaac? And then at the end of
his faith.
That was his faith, right? But he didn't just say, oh, I believe in God. He got up and went and did what God told him to do, right? So that's what it says. You have to have the works, or you keeping God's commandments, doing what God said to do.
That's what the difference is between God telling him. But when Jesus came, he says, I mean, I believe that God so loved the world that he came to earth as a man named Jesus.
So you think God made himself come down and come into Mary's stomach and then be born out, and that was God?
I believe that our Creator, the immaculate creation.
Well, look, let's deal with that, right? This is Deuteronomy 18, verse 18. Verse 15. The Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me, unto him ye shall hearken. He said, like unto his brethren, like unto me. Speaking of Moses, speaking of the Israelites. Now, how did they come into the world? They came through the world. They came into the world. But he said, I'll raise up a prophet amongst our people, right? Like, just like your people. You know what I'm saying? He'll raise them up through the seed line, all right? Because that's how all of us come in the world, man. You know what I'm saying?
But it says Jesus is the spirit of prophecy.
Yeah, but you got that in Romans? Romans 1 and 3?
This is the book of Romans, chapter 1 and the 3rd verse. It says, concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, according to the flesh.
Which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. So wait a second.
What is seed?
Seed.
Sperm, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So he's the sperm.
That's our difference is I believe Jesus was created through immaculate creation.
Okay. So no seed at all?
So are you calling Gabriel and are you calling God a liar in the scriptures?
No.
In the gospel is just a lie.
It says
the Virgin will give birth to Emmanuel, which is God with us. That's why Christians and disciples of Jesus Christ believe that Jesus is God, a deity, but not. It's more like he's the bringer. He was even in the Old Testament, he was the speaker.
But the word virgin just means woman of marriageable age. You know what I'm saying?
So even in our, like right now,
that is,
a virgin is a woman without sexual intercourse.
But that's the world definition according to the scriptures. You can even go look it up in the Hebrew. You can even look it up in the Hebrew and the Greek. It's talking about a woman of marriageable age. It's not talking about she didn't have sex. It just meant that she was a woman of marriageable age. Okay? You know what I'm saying? So what does that mean? That can mean that it could be any young girl walking around. That's,
the word virgin that was there didn't mean a woman who's never had sex. That's not what that word meant.
So saying that, then even Mary Magdalene, she's like a woman called her husband, my Lord, right?
Right.
So then there's a, like in Hebrews, they would all, every Hebrew would get married. You know what I'm saying? It was natural for a Hebrew man to get married by a Jew.
Look, I'm going to get the one in Isaiah. I'm going to show you. Look, I'm going to show you in Isaiah, the 13th chapter. I'm going to look it up in the concordance.
Isaiah is the prophecy of the coming of the church.
Well, no, he's a prophet. He's a prophecy. He's a prophet of many prophecies. Okay, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call him Emmanuel.
That's what you're talking about. Remember that? Now watch this. So,
all right, this is Strong's H5959.
Let him see.
Alama.
That's what the word for virgin was, the Hebrew word. Because over here, when you hear the word virgin, you're thinking of a woman who's never had sex before.
Virgin.
But the Bible wasn't written in English.
Marriageable age, made or newly married. Now let's get the definition in the scriptures on what marriage is. All
right. Joseph was a righteous man, right? So that means that Joseph's going to do whatever the Bible says to do. Now, when Joseph is with Mary, if all of a sudden out of nowhere he had never had sex with her, but all of a sudden she just ends up pregnant out of nowhere,
16.
It doesn't matter. She can't just all of a sudden be with a righteous man and all of a sudden she's just pregnant. The Bible tells you if a woman goes and has sex with anybody else, that's adultery. You're supposed to kill her. So if he's a righteous man and his wife is pregnant by somebody else, he would kill his wife. He wouldn't try to put her away privately and make it cool like that. He wouldn't do that. You know what I'm saying?
He was upright.
There was a reason why. It's because he had sex with this woman and she was pregnant and they didn't have the ceremony first. You know what I'm saying?
But why would he be mad at her?
He wasn't mad at her.
He didn't have sex with her.
He wasn't mad at her.
And it says she was pregnant.
Why would he be mad at her? If you're married to a woman and she's never had sex before, this is your wife, right?
She was pregnant.
Huh? Yeah, but all of a sudden she's pregnant? You wouldn't care about that?
I mean, I would care, but...
But not too much? That's not even a big deal?
But I would realize that it's not my seed.
Huh?
It's not...
Okay.
Yeah, you would realize it's not your seed if you never had sex with her before on somebody else's seed. Obviously,
Gabriel,
God in her, she's pregnant.
Gabriel revealed to Joseph that
part of Israel.
Okay. Now, according to the Bible, this is what marriage is, right? This is Exodus chapter 22, verse 16. If a man entice a maid that is not betrothed and lie with her, he shall surely endow her to be his wife.
That's right. So sex is marriage according to the Bible. There's no go get on one knee and propose with a ring. That's not in the Bible, you know what I'm saying?
Right. And that goes back to Babylonian.